you all yourself, you know. On more than one occasion, I've been at a conference saying, sit up straight, yeah, stand up yourselves. It's really been a tough year, and I can understand why people feel like that. Money is tight, we've got more people than ever before needing our help, and there's a very negative and often quite ignorant narrative from politicians and the media about charities. Actually, I thought the same last year, but somehow it seems to have got worse. Never before in my long career in the voluntary sector, I actually felt like I was the enemy, suddenly, for working for charity. It makes no sense to me whatsoever. I don't understand how people can't appreciate the massive contribution that's made by the hundreds of thousands of our charities who are serving people in this country and all across the world trying to make things better. I don't understand why journalists and politicians and pundits have been so quick to jump on this anti-charity bandwagon based on wildly exaggerated reporting of pay and fundraising methods. And then when you read the stories, you know, the newspaper stories about charities, then the comments sections. My team actually always tell me never ever read the comments. And mostly I don't. But when you do, you really bitterly regret it because this vile invective that comes out that people write in the comment section is absolutely amazing. People say, I'm going to give to charity, they're all greedy and lazy and, you know, sticking on and not doing anything with it. I just don't get it. And there's been this constant stream of criticism, particularly this year, there's no doubt about that. There's also no doubt that some of our sector has been at fault. There's no question about that. You know, we haven't been able to hold our heads completely high. But not to the extent that justifies what I think has been a massive overreaction from both within the charity sector and at political level, with wild assertions that public trust and confidence is irretrievably being damaged by what's been going on in the sector. And yet, people, in the last few weeks alone, BBC Children in Need raised a record-breaking £37.1 million, their highest ever. Only last week, we had Giving Tuesday, where donations made on the day were up 35% on the previous year. The evidence just does not back up the rhetoric. So I wonder if what we're combating here is not a real problem, but it's a perception of a problem which we do need to deal with. So I think we can't give up or give in. Our job in the voluntary sector is to be purveyors of hope. When we're working with a young addict, we don't accept it if they say to us they can't give up drink or drugs because it's too difficult. We tell them, yes, you can, and we'll help you. When we're working with learning disabled people, we don't tell them they can't grow and learn and have wonderful feeling lives. We tell them, yes, you can, and we'll help. When we're working with bereaved parents who've lost a child and they say they can't go on, we tell them, yes, you can, and we'll help. When we're faced with a lonely elderly person who asks us, what's the point? We don't say, you're right, there is no point. We say, we'll help you to the final point. And that is why the voluntary sector is so amazing. And it's so clearly a better answer for serving the vulnerable and the needy than the private sector is. Because in the voluntary sector, it doesn't matter how hard it is. It doesn't matter how much criticism we get or how much vile invective get chucked at us. We do not give up and we never walk away, ever. Ever, 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 no matter what people say. Your success as a charity, and in this room in particular, has got nothing whatsoever to do with how much money you've got or how big you are. Big or small, it's what you do with what you've got that matters. Money is only a resource, and sometimes we've got lots of it, and sometimes we haven't. And usually that's down to luck or timing. It's not because one charity is maybe better than another. Because in the end, charities are living democracy. Democracy in action. There is something absolutely magical about the ability of folk to come together in service of the cause that they care about. Isn't that what democratic engagement is? It's not just about voting and elections, it's about all of us coming together and doing things that we think are important, that we think matters. And the reality is, if we don't come together in the voluntary sector and speak, provide solutions and speak truth to power, then who will? Who else is going to say these things? And in this current climate, this sort of negative aura in which we're operating, it's even more important not to lose that fire in our bellies. To remember that the causes and people we serve matter, and we have to speak up for them, and we have to continue our work. George Bernard Shaw said, reasonable men adapt themselves to their circumstances, unreasonable men adapt their circumstances to themselves. And that is why all progress depends upon the unreasonable man. It is our job to be unreasonable, to be bloody unreasonable, actually. We don't take no for an answer. We stand up and fight for our beneficiaries, no matter how hard it is, because what we do matters, and it matters to them. When we're faced with this negativity about charities, on the hand to defend ourselves, when we're accused of being badly run, and people ask, why should I give? This is what I want you to say to them. Okay? This is what I want you to say to those critics. You should give because one day you and your family may well need a charity. When you're in trouble and can't afford help and have been abandoned by the state, it'll be a charity, like the Citizens Advice Bureau, who helps and advises you. When you are old and infirm, it can be a charity such as Age UK that provides support. If you get cancer, it can be a cancer charity that helps you like Billen, and a cancer charity that funds research into a cure, like Cancer Research UK. When you want your kids to grow and develop skills beyond education, it can be a charity that helps, like the Scouts or Go Riding. If you have a pet and can't afford a vet, it can be a charity like the PDSA that's there for you. If you're desperately unlucky and any of your family become terminally ill, it can be a charity like Richard's House Hospice or the Hospice Movement that helps you. If you love sport or you enjoy the outdoors, it can be a charity that makes that possible, like Farm Rugby Club, the Wildlife Trust. And that's just a tiny count of the absolutely enormous number of charities, some big, some small, some global, some local, that are working their butts off to make our world a better place and succeeding in doing so. The NHS would collapse without the support of charities. Without charities, your taxes would be even higher than they already are in order to pay for the crucial services that the charities provide. The list of people and causes our UK charities support is endless. Charities are all around you. You just need to look and listen. There is not a single human being in the UK, regardless of their age, economic status or background, that has not, is not or will not benefit from the work of a charity. You can't always rely on the state to help. You can always rely on the charity. Most of the negative media stories about charities are over-exaggerated hype. Don't fall for it. We have the best charitable sector in the whole wide world. That's what you should say. Which brings me to our keynote speaker, who's delivering DSC's annual social change lecture. Now, he follows in a long line of